Yo, I'm Black Ice.
And I'm Akees.
Yo, welcome to the Black Narrative. Hope everybody had a great Thursday. It's been a long month.
Man.
I feel like in January, 50, 52nd right now. Like,
oh my goodness, man! This month felt like three.
Yeah, it did, man. I mean, January.
I thought
January
we were halfway through the year.
Hey, man, I was like, man, it's just been so much going on though, and as you know, with the past few shows, like going on in the nation and whatnot. So, but yeah, so tonight we decided to keep it a little bit on a lighter note, man.
Let's end off on a good note.
Yeah, cause it's been a little heavy, man. But if you're here, go ahead and hit the like button for us. If you're first time here, hit subscribe and hit the notification bell. We're here every Tuesday and Thursday night, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We cover a lot of variety of topics pertaining to the black community. Tonight, we're going to do going through black music. This is our second part.
Right.
We did this before, and a lot of you loved what we did the first time. We did, too. I mean, it was very fun. So we thought it would be a perfect opportunity to do a part two, finally.
It's just, it's amazing to be able to go through and, I mean, not only experience and explore music, but also to be able to hear the stories behind these artists and songs.
Yeah,
you know?
Right. So, yeah, oh, yeah. So, you know, by the way, the intro music y'all been hearing, our music channel is finally up and going. It's up and running. It's called Yoshi Vibes Music. So you so definitely you just subscribe to it if you like the music that you hear on the intro.
Yeah.
We make trap salsa mixes. So basically what it is. So and this was just the logo is here. As it's Yoshi Vibes, and of course we got a new merch in the Black Narrative store.
If you can't see, do you have it pulled up?
Well, no, we had the link in the bio in the description. Well, you can also go to the blacknarrative.tv.
And what kind of stuff do we have on with the merch?
With the Black Narrative merch, we had the mugs and the hoodies, and we had the t-shirts.
Masks.
And we had the Yahweh mask on our Black Narrative shop. And then on the Yoshi shop,
right.
You know, we had the hoodies and a couple of t-shirts. And we got phone cases and some other stuff. So we're always working on stuff. We're always working on different projects. We have more stuff that's coming out that we've been working on. So hopefully, like, next week, you may even have more stuff to show you.
Yes. Yeah.
Like, even with the Yoshi channel, we were working on that for months, trying to get the animation done and everything. So we're glad that's up and running. And I do have new mixes coming up for that channel probably next month. So y'all willing. So, you know, we always working on different things, you know.
Right.
We stay very, very busy between
grow,
shows.
Man.
This is a pro-black show, you know, man, but we want to have some dope branding and be creative with it as well.
Right,
we want
right.
to be a, I mean, it's still entertainment as well, right?
Have fun with it.
Right. So, you know, but I hope you had a great week. Tonight, like I said, we're bringing out some music history.
Yeah.
And also, we're going to find some fun stories that we're going to go through, too.
Oh, man.
You know, I had a couple personal stories, you know, like before we started doing this show. I worked in the music industry for a few years when I had the magazine and everything. And, but yeah, I found it interesting. So I like interesting stories. Like, you hear these songs or see some of these artists. I like to hear some of the things behind the scenes that got to that point.
To kind of get a not only with the music, but kind of get a taste of different artists and how these different personalities interact.
Yeah, it's cool. So it's not a variety, man. Like we'll be going everywhere from jazz to funk to hip hop. So, and that's just us as individuals. Like, you know, we listen to a variety of music as well. So it's fun putting together the show, you know, and whatnot. So we're gonna start off with the Beatles. Well, first of all, we show you a preview from the last, the part one. If you haven't seen it, it's on our channel. It's on our channel. But this is a sample of part one that we did.
September 3rd, 2020. Man, that was so long. Man,
yeah, I didn't know it was so long ago that we did it. Yeah, we did the first part September 3rd.
Shalom.
So this is a sample of part one. So tonight is part two. And so we're going to start off with the Beatles.
Yeah, we might make this a little... All right, so the story behind... So we know how, you know, black artists will make a song and it'll be a little more... It might be a known song, but it won't break records the way that pop artists will take off.
Right.
You know? So it's one of those things where the Beatles, a very big group, covered or had a version of the song that a lot of people know. And it's the common story of it was commandeered.
Yeah, it happened a lot. I mean, it was a time where black people couldn't be on the cover in their own records.
Right.
And then, like you say, you know, oftentimes, especially like the Motown era, like white people redo the song. So, and it's so funny how the Beatles are put on this pedestal of this rock band, and they, you know, they took shit. You know, original. So
all the way from England too.
Yeah, you know what I mean. So we're going to show you the Beatles version, which is the most popular version of this song, and then we show you that we watch the original version that was done by black women.
Because some people don't even know about the original
version. Right. So we start off. It's the original version. Oh yes,
wait a minute, because as you see, we weren't able to see, but the Beatles version was from a couple years later.
Right.
So it wasn't like there was even a big gap between when the song
came out. We put that in part one when Elvis stole some songs too.
It was very recent.
Yeah. Man, wait, hey, Mr. Bowman. Like the soul in that,
man.
Night and day. The difference is night and day.
They had seasoning in it, man.
Yeah,
background vocals and everything.
Yeah, yeah. The Beatles like unseasoned chicken.
Right, and that's the thing. You're able to just hear. I mean, not only the soul, but the song feels more full. It feels a lot more fleshed out.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Oh, they said they play the black version at my job all the time. That's what's up. Okay, that's what's up.
That's good.
Yeah, yeah. Because I know a lot of places I hear the Beatles version. So. That's a rarity, at least for me anyway.
A lot of people don't even know this version.
Yeah, but that's dope that they played the original one at your job. You know, so the next one here, this is a woman named Sylvia Robinson, I believe. And she had some hits back in the 50s. And we're going to show her briefly her music career and how she transitioned over to hip-hop after that.
And I mean, it's kind of crazy how much of a stark difference it is. So we'll see the first song, the classic song.
Yeah.
Very big year for records. Let's welcome Mickey and Sylvia. Here they are. Believe it or not, as I understand the story, Mickey, you did not want to record Love is Strange, and Sylvia talked you into it. What did you say to him to win the argument?
Come here, lover boy.
And here it is. Love is
Strange. Yeah.
Love is strange. Yeah, yeah. Lot of people take it for a game. Once you
he's plugging that thing, man.
Yeah.
We hope you're not getting flat tonight, so we try to be careful with what we're doing here.
Oh, yeah.
But, yeah, so she transitioned from that into being the one, some call her like the godmother of hip-hop. So we're going to go to what she did later on in her life here.
I'm a type of person that never like to copy things that are out there. I always like to come with something new, something different. And I felt as though if I came with a concept like this, either it was going to hit or it was going to miss. And I really felt strong about it, that it was going to be a hit.
Yeah. Released September 6, 1979, Rapper's Delight by the Sugar Hill Gang was not the first song to feature rapping, but it's widely considered to be the record that ushered rap into the public arena and spawned a billion-dollar industry.
While part of it was before exposing her back like that.
While Rapper's Delight,
I guess you need
iron. Right?
has been recognized by the Library of Congress as culturally, historically, and aesthetically significant. Little attention has been given to Sylvia Robinson, the revolutionary music producer and label executive behind the hit record. Born Sylvia Vanderpool on March 6, 1936 in Harlem, she began her career as a solo artist signed to Columbia Records at age 14, before teaming with a Louisville, Kentucky guitarist, Mickey Baker, to form the group Mickey and Sylvia in 1954. 5 years later, Sylvia married Joe Robinson. The Robinsons founded All Platinum Records in 1967 and scored a string of hits, including the million-selling Love on a Two-Way Street by The Moments, which Sylvia co-wrote and produced. In 1973, Sylvia wrote, produced, and performed Pillow Talk, which hit number 3 on the pop charts. Robinson would later go on to found the hip-hop label Sugar Hill Records, but initially had trouble finding artists because most of the popular rappers who performed in clubs, like Eddie Chiba and DJ Hollywood, didn't want to record. So Robinson persuaded a young man she discovered at a New Jersey pizzeria to record someone else's lyrics over an instrumental to the hit song Good Times by popular disco-funk group Chic. The result was Rapper's Delight, which would go on to sell a reported 5 million copies, enabling Sugar Hill Records to expand and recruit better talent, like Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five, whose 1980 hit The Message introduced street consciousness to hip-hop lyrics and became the first rap song preserved in the National Recording Registry by the Library of Congress.
It's interesting how Sylvia Robinson brought Grandmaster Flash and The Message.
Yeah.
And then later, a Jewish dude brought N.W.A. Ain't that interesting?
You hijacked this that quickly, right?
Right.
Yeah, I mean, I heard the story many times of Rapper's Delight, but I really didn't hear about her.
Right,
you
right.
know, and so I really want to give her props and seeing for her own musical career that she had since she was 14 years old. So by the time she came up with Sugar Hill Records, she was already in the industry almost 20 years.
Man.
And then took a gamble with the hip-hop, because you got to remember, that's a fresh new genre, and she took a big chance.
Wow, the fact that they didn't even, the rappers that were in the clubs didn't even want to record.
Yeah, right, yeah, that was wild. Well, but they stick to what was familiar with them.
Right.
You talked about that before. You know, he stick to what's unknown territory.
Yeah, exactly. They're complacent.
Yeah, you know, they probably regretted it later.
Oh, boy, did they.
You know? This next one. Oh, I guess I had this on twice. Okay, that's fine. Go to the next video here.
Friends are gonna try to move your feet. You see, I am Wonder Mike, and I like to say hello. Up to the black, to the white, the red, and the brown, and the purple, and yellow. But first, I gotta bang, bang, the boogie to the boogie, say up, jump.
Look at them get down.
Bang, boogie, let's rock. You don't stop, rock the rhythm, that'll make your body rock.
Yo, Keith, do you got an outfit just like that on the red?
I think
right
I'm
here?
Green.
Yeah,
I think I got that in green.
So, well, you've heard my voice, but I brought two friends along.
I got somewhere
and next on the mic is my man Hank. Come on, Hank, sing that song. Check it out. When I'm pimp, the dimp, the ladies pimp, the women fight for my delight. But I'm the
man
master with the three MCs that shock the house for the young ladies. And when you come inside into the front, you do the freak spank, or do the bump. And when the sucker MCs try to prove a point, they trust the trio. With a serious joiner from sun to sun and from day to day.
Man, they're going off. It trip me out. This song is like 6 minutes long, 6.5 minutes long to be a single.
Man, and it's interesting to think about, because I mean we hear it in this time, and I mean it sounds like a old hip hop song. But man, imagine when it was new.
Yeah, like, it's like people so refreshing. Like minds. They didn't know what it was, but they just know they loved it.
Right.
You know, yo, if you're getting dropped frames on the videos, we apologize. I think it's the internet on our end. But as far as I know, the audio is still good. But hopefully, Comcast.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, let me not say it. Right, yeah, if we get pulled off air, for real.
But I already know.
You know, we must get the next one. We're going to go into John Coltrane now. Now, this John Coltrane, we're about to watch. This is not a bio. It's basically breaking down how he changed the game with his song, My Favorite Things. Because, you know, it was somebody else's song. In this case, it was a white song.
Right.
and the black person took it, and we just made it fresh, you know.
Right. And it's interesting the way he played with the melody.
Yeah. My favorite thing, one of my favorite Coltrane songs. Anyway, I mean, the way he did it. They really gonna break down how he changed the game with this particular track.
Right.
And I heard many different variations of it. I mean, the last variation.
Yeah.
Andre 3000 did it. You know, A Love Below, and you know he did his own drum and bass version of it, and I thought that was really dope.
Right.
And everything, but John Coltrane. I mean, he has such an extensive catalog of different styles. Like, he really challenged himself in jazz.
And I think that's what I wanted. It's kind of like, you know, people in, like, the culinary world where, well, you have a sandwich, but then you have a sandwich deconstructed.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, you
that's
know,
how I feel. He played with the song and played with the melody in order to make it something that, if you listen, is similar, but it's still its own being.
The song is still like, you hear the song, it still sounds familiar, but he put a whole different twist on it. It was really, really dope.
Exactly.
And I really love, so I'm so glad I found this video of them actually break down what he did to the song. I didn't realize he did so much to the song.
Right.
I just knew I loved it, you know. And then after finding this video, like putting it in the show, like, yo, I went back and listened to it on Spotify. I had it on repeat. Excuse me. I mean, it was that dope. So just check it out.
This video is sponsored by Skillshare for a limited
time.
Right.
It's a far cry from the original version of the song. My Favorite Things was written by Rodgers and Hammerstein, a powerhouse duo of musical theater who are...
Hammerstein, so you already know where they are.
...are responsible for half of everything you know about Broadway musicals. Working in the 1940s, the two of them kickstarted the golden age of musicals. When they came onto the scene, musicals were built around showcasing the biggest stars of the day, like Ethel Merman. Rodgers and Hammerstein still cared about their stars, but their process prioritized something else, the narratives of the show. They knew that by crafting compelling, relatable stories, you could entrance audiences in a whole new way. This approach set the standard for nearly all musicals to come. Without the influence of Rodgers and Hammerstein, none of these would exist, as well as probably any other musical you love. The last musical that Rodgers and Hammerstein ever made together was The Sound of Music, which debuted on Broadway in 1959.
When you hear what The Sound of Music is about, you see the connection with Hammerstein.
Oh yeah?
A little bit more.
Yeah.
It was an instant classic. When it was adapted into a movie a decade later, it won 5 Academy Awards and became the highest-grossing film of all time to that date. One of the most beloved songs from The Sound of Music was My Favorite Things.
These are a few of my favorite things.
The song strikes a simple, primal nerve, singing about the innocent joy. It serves to display the plucky optimism of the show's heroine, Maria. In the silver screen version, this role was brought to life by Julie Andrews, but before Andrews made the role her own, it was performed on Broadway by Mary Martin.
Raindrops on roses and whiskers on kittens.
Well, My Favorite Things...
I can't even front, man. Even the original version sounds good.
Yeah, man.
...works as light-hearted, standard fare, the song is actually sung on the backdrop of a harrowing story. The Sound of Music takes place in Austria in 1938, as Nazi Germany was rising to power. It's based on the true story of the Von Trapp family singers as they fled from the Nazis. This story provided a cheery salve for a generation that was still reeling from the trauma of World War II. And nowhere was that more clear than My Favorite Things.
I simply remember my favorite things, and then I will feel so bad.
So, what what is it about this cheerful populist song that attracted one of the most?
Yeah, but yeah, one thing I love about the music back then, man, the music itself, like they had a full orchestra. You know what I mean?
Man, and that's one thing that I could say is you really don't get much musicals like that in this day and age. I mean, we see the music, the movie industry.
You know, yeah, in this day and age.
But back then, I mean, you look at different musicals from Annie to The Sound of Music, even all these different musicals. The songs were, I mean, of course, you had the orchestra, but they you felt them.
We know, to me, even go beyond the musical, this music period.
Right.
Like you talk about Motown, the other, like they always had a full band. Right, James Brown, full band. Like,
right, exactly.
And like, yeah, you know, you got technology now to make it a lot easier and cheaper to produce certain sounds. And it do sound good. There's a lot of music that I love today done off a laptop, but it is a certain quality about hearing some of this music from decades ago that's, you know, you just like, I remember when Quincy Jones had a beef with Kanye.
Word.
Yeah, it was like petty artists, they just petty. And you know, but Quincy like, yeah, you know, Kanye dope, but can he write a whole orchestra though? You know what I mean? Like, you know, he was on that tip. And like, yeah, true, but Kanye was still hot, you know what I mean, when he came out. I mean he's good at what he did and he's just able to do it with less resources. Right. But that can't knock what Quincy has done. I mean, yeah, Quincy was a musical genius. I mean, yeah, I know some people may have their thoughts about Quincy of his personal life choices per se, but.
Right, but in the realm of music,
He's genius. I mean, like, can't touch him, you know what I mean? So, yeah, it is a certain quality about it I still love, that I love to hear.
That's why I feel like there's, even when it comes to organized noise.
Prime example.
Live instrumentation. Yeah. That's why I have a friend of mine who's into producing, and I was telling him, I was like, man, you have to have a human touch
to it.
Music. That's why it's good to, if you want to produce, learn your keyboard. Learn your keyboard in a way where somebody's able to come to you and hum a melody, and then you're able to play it.
Look at 3000. He's a top five rapper on almost anybody's list.
Right.
And what we doing? Every time we see him, what he doing now? He walk around playing around with a damn flute. One of the best rappers that hit the game, hit the microphone, playing a flute in the airport. You know what I mean? So, I mean, but he really into the music, though, and it shows through their music.
Exactly.
You know?
Most innovative minds in all of jazz? To understand that, we need to look at where Coltrane was when he got his hands on the song in 1960. For almost his entire career, Coltrane had been at the forefront of experimentation in jazz. The same year that The Sound of Music debuted on Broadway, Coltrane recorded Giant Steps, a song that pushed the style of bebop to its logical extreme and has since become a rite of passage in jazz circles. But Coltrane and his contemporaries weren't satisfied with simply breaking bebop. They were on a constant quest to find the next new thing. And they found it with a school of thought known as modal jazz. Pioneered by the composer and theorist George Russell, modal jazz provided a new way of looking at music. Rather than basing the music around chord progressions like bebop did, modal jazz was based on musical modes. To oversimplify, modes are specific kinds of scales, and building songs around these scales rather than chords gives musicians freedom to experiment and to modulate through different tone centers. The result is a kind of open freedom in music that the rigid structures of bebop didn't allow for. Miles Davis displayed the power of this concept on his 1959 album Kind of Blue, which features Coltrane on tenor sax. As two of the brightest minds in all of jazz, Coltrane and Davis were constantly encouraging each other to push new boundaries. In fact, it was Miles Davis who bought Coltrane a soprano saxophone when the two were touring in Europe together. Armed with a new instrument and a new school of music.
And it's interesting because black artists often, like for instance, even the Parliaments and people who did funk, you got to realize how much artistry went into breaking the genres down.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, the detail.
Right.
And I also thinking about how, yeah, two young black men on tour in Europe, man, looking out for each other, too. I thought, I mean, that's cool to hear that. You know, he bought them an instrument while they were on tour. Like, I can imagine the ventures they had during that time period. You know what I mean?
Right. That kind of, that synergy met by, you know, the love of music and also that brotherhood.
Right, but I think they probably had a brotherhood between them too.
Exactly.
Musical thought, Coltrane set out to record his own albums, showcasing the power of modal jazz. But while Kind of Blue used original compositions, Coltrane decided to apply modal jazz to popular, familiar standards. He took on George Gershwin's classic Summertime, as well as Cole Porter's Every Time We Say Goodbye. By looking towards popular songs, Coltrane was making a statement. He was drawing the attention of the mainstream and showing them the power that modal jazz had as a concept. But that still doesn't fully answer our question. Why did Coltrane center his album around a song from a recent musical and not another piece from the Great American Songbook? Well, to answer that question, I thought it would be best to call in someone who is far more qualified to talk about this sort of thing than me. Adam Neely.
Well, there's so much that you could talk about when it comes to my favorite things, but I wanted to talk specifically about form and structure as it relates to the original song, because I think there's something unique about it that made it so appealing to Coltrane when he wanted to turn it into modal jazz. Now, typical Broadway and Tin Pan Alley songs of the era follow an AABA form, which is called song form. My favorite things is a little bit unusual in that it follows an AAA prime B form. So the bridge actually occurs at the very end of the structure. The A section's melody, which we hear three times in a row, focuses very heavily on the root, the perfect fifth up from the root, and then the major second up from the root. What's very interesting about this melody is that there are no thirds present. And thirds are very important in melodies and harmonies because they define whether or not a tonality is minor or major. And what that basically means here is that we can hear the same melody in both minor and major. Super cool. This is exactly what happens in the original recording. The first two A sections are in minor, and then that third A section, the A prime section, is in major. And Coltrane and his band ruthlessly exploited this kind of major-minor duality with their recording, furiously exploring ideas in minor and then also exploring ideas in the parallel major. There's a big difference in feeling.
Chemistry of Coltrane's quartet. In addition to Steve Davis's anchoring bass line, Coltrane's dancing soprano is supported by McCoy Tyner's piano vamps and Elvin Jones's jazz waltz group. When Coltrane comes in with his melody, it's different than the Rodgers and Hammerstein original. Coltrane's version of the melody is syncopated, and he adds a short vamp to the end of each phrase. This allows him to pull you into a hypnotic spiral. And once you're in, it's hard to get out. Fueled by simple, repetitive vamps, McCoy Tyner and Coltrane are able to exchange solos, exploring that interaction between major and minor. Coltrane's modal explorations were inspired by the innovations of George Russell and Miles Davis, but there was another key inspiration behind his take on My Favorite Things, Indian classical music. One key feature of Indian music is the raga, an improvisational framework that is not unlike modes in Western music. The Indian influence also comes through in Davis's bass line. Indian classical music is usually anchored by a simple, low, droning part. Drawing from Indian music allows Coltrane to stretch Rodgers and Hammerstein's piece to its very extremes. The original song clocks in at a little over 2 minutes, while Coltrane's studio version flirts with the 14-minute mark.
He took a 2.5 minute song and put it to 14 minutes.
Man, that's how much he played with it, man.
Yeah, right. Yeah, right. Like, man, but and I love every minute of it.
Right.
You know, it wasn't like, you didn't feel like the song dragged too long. And after watching this, I love the song even more. I love the song as regular, like as a listener.
Right.
But hearing these jazz teachers and musicians break down the how technical it was what they did.
Right.
Made me appreciate it even more.
Man,
you know, go back listening to it.
And that's one thing, even dealing with the live instrumentation, is that interaction between the players.
The band was tight.
Right.
Like, it wasn't just like him, the whole band was.
With the instruments.
Man.
There's that communication. And then you're able to just make something just so amazing yet or organic out of that.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, because he could do it by himself. Like, as a collective, it just took him to a whole nother level.
Exactly.
This is wild enough on its own, but what's even crazier is the structure of Coltrane's exploration. Rather than putting the B section at the end of three A sections like the original song, Coltrane holds off. For 12 and a half minutes, he repeats his modified take on the A sections, and then finally, in the last moments of the song, Coltrane introduces the B section before bringing things home. This creates an astounding kind of catharsis, finally freeing you from the looping trance of vamps that have defined most of the song. Coltrane released My Favorite Things in 1961, and it instantly became one of the most commercially successful songs of his entire career. The album was certified gold, and the song itself even got issued as a single, an extreme rarity for jazz of that time. By turning to Broadway, and to some of the greatest songwriters of all time, Coltrane was able to find a song that could simultaneously push jazz experimentation and appeal to a more widespread audience. To me, John Coltrane's take on My Favorite Things is emblematic of what makes jazz such a dynamic, exciting genre of music. Coltrane was able to take a song written by an all-time master and exploit its composition. In doing so, he transformed the piece into a wholly unique listening experience.
And he did that.
Right. That's the thing with jazz, man. It's such a technical art form.
Right, you know, right.
And how much. And it's funny because when it looks easy, I mean, as easy as it can.
Right, right.
As easy as it can.
But, I mean, even what we're doing, people could look at us like, oh, yeah, this is easy. We can just put the show together.
Right.
But then I hear the amount of hours we hear before the show, putting the show together and production and everything.
And that's the same thing when it comes to them training.
Yeah.
Them training to make the music and the amount of technical skill it takes for them to just do stuff on the fly and also interact and make a good piece.
Yeah. And they took a chance. Right. I mean, they took a big risk by doing that. So we're gonna flip it over to some funk now.
Oh yes, let's get into
it. Hey, man, I like doing this show, man. I just love music, man. So I hope y'all enjoying the vibe tonight. So,
hey LA, are you there?
Hey Nari, I'm here. What's up?
Hey, I wanted to ask you a question. First, listen to this. Hey. Sounds like a James Brown song, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But it's not. What is it about this that we're both hearing that makes us think of James Brown? What's going on musically that makes James Brown sound like James Brown?
1, 2, 3, 4! Get up, get on up!
Screams, spins, and splits all make for a great show, but what was the minister of the new super heavy funk doing? To answer that question, we have to go back to 1964, when funk was born.
So a lot of people say that funk started with Papa's Got a Brand New Bag in 1965. Others say it started in 1967 with Cold Sweat. But James Brown says in his autobiography that his sound really started to change in 1964 with his album Out of Sight.
You got your highest eagles on.
Out of Sight was another beginning, musically and professionally. You can hear the band in me start to move in a whole nother direction. The guitar, the vocals, everything was starting to be used to establish all kinds of rhythms at once. I was trying to get every aspect of the production to contribute to the rhythmic patterns.
You know you're out of sight.
Brown got away from melodies.
His music is stank, bro. It is this funky, bro.
It's funky.
I mean, like, all the instruments together, man, with his voice, man. Just, I didn't even that snippet. Like, God damn.
And that's, I think that's one thing that would be interesting to get into later on is, because, I mean, of course, we know that James Brown may understand how much he influenced the genre.
Yeah. Like
the fact that there was even a tie between him and Parliament's Funkadelic.
Yeah. That time period, man. This music period, like, you got to think about it. We just saw My Favorite Things came out around that same time.
Right.
Oh, even Mr. Postman came around the same time. Like,
man,
that era just, like, so much variety.
What I like is the fact that, like, for instance, Bootsie Collins was on his band,
mm-hmm.
but it was one of those things where he didn't know because he played an instrument.
Yeah, right.
So somebody that played an instrument in the background could then grow and
their own blossom as their own artist. But yeah, I guess like Jimi Hendrix
to a whole different genre, like push the genre.
Yeah. Like, I think Jimi Hendrix played for Ike and Tina.
What?
Yeah, like, he played in their band, and he branched out in his short career. Like, it's crazy.
His music was very rhythmically focused. Even the timbre, his delivery style was percussive.
Yeah.
And I think that's what made funk such a grooving, such a popular sound, because even the musicians, they're not really always singing. It's more group chanting, but it's not driven by a series of chords. It's driven by rhythmic interactions.
And not only was he using every instrument to add to the song's rhythmic pattern, but he was creating a whole new pattern. So most music of that era gave heavy emphasis to the backbeat on the two and the four of the measure. It sounded like this. One, two, three, four. What James Brown did was he put the emphasis on the one,
mm-hmm.
on the downbeat of the measure. And that sounds like. Emphasizing the one created space in the groove so that the band could add syncopation to the other beats.
Man.
Syncopation is just placing rhythms or accents in places where we don't expect it. So if these are the strong beats, three, four, one, two, three, four, syncopation is just putting accents in between the strong beats. So it sound like one, and two, and three, and four, and boom, ka-ka-boom, ka-ka-boom, ka-ka-boom.
So here are some of the observations that I picked up while listening to James Brown's songs. The first thing is that...
And I like the whole, how they break down the thing with the one, because with the Parliaments, they were so influenced by it that they had a song called Everything Is On The One.
Yeah, so it makes sense.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, but you can hear the difference, though, when you hit it on the downbeat. Like,
right.
It just punches
it
in.
It hits.
It hits, you know? Yeah, man. We're going to move forward, man, because we got a lot we want to cover. We're gonna go over to Maurice White.
Oh yeah.
Maurice White, the leader and founder of Earth, Wind & Fire, died late Wednesday in his home in Los Angeles.
This is 2016, yeah, so it wasn't this past week.
He was 74. The producer, writer, singer, and drummer had been fighting Parkinson's disease and stopped touring in the mid-1990s. For many baby boomers, Earth, Wind & Fire provided a funky soundtrack to their youth. In the 70s, White established Earth, Wind & Fire as one of the most successful bands of the era with its genre-defying sound. Let you know. Earth, Wind & Fire had 16 top singles, won 6 Grammys, and sold an estimated 90 million albums. The band was...
90 million albums.
Man,
90 million. That's crazy.
Man.
Was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 2000. White himself was separately inducted into the Songwriters Hall of Fame in 2010. Maurice White was born on December 19, 1941 in Memphis, Tennessee, a center of blues, early rock and roll, and soul music. White began his career as a jazz drummer and played various percussion instruments with Earth, Wind, and Fire. The band became renowned for its stage shows marked by pyrotechnics, choreography, and lighting effects. Maurice White and his band were a big influence on generations of funk, soul, and hip-hop acts to follow. Roots drummer Questlove on his Instagram account wrote, "You know how hard it is to present Afrocentric jazz and spiritual positivity in the face of what we had to deal with in the 70s? Earth, Wind, and Fire was our Black Floyd, or the Black Beatles." Rapper Q-Tip from A Tribe Called Quest posted on his Twitter account, "Earth, Wind, and Fire was the blueprint for Tribe. Rest in peace to the genius that was Maurice White."
Hey, that's man.
Man, and it's phenomenal seeing the artists like Questlove and Q-Tip looking back.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and giving props to what influenced them, because, and it's interesting how a genre from a time before can influence the new generation, a new genre, a new sound.
Well, even Tribe Called Quest had a lot of jazz influence. So I mean, so it made sense. So you know they speaking truth from what they were saying about them. You saw it in their music. They wouldn't say, "Oh yeah, rest in peace, Maurice." Like, no, you could tell these were real fans of these people's music, even with the roots. You know, this next video is a story of the between the group of Earth, Wind, and Fire, of how they came together.
This weekend, the 42nd annual Kennedy Center honors celebrated music legends Earth, Wind, and Fire. The Jonas Brothers performed one of the band's many hit songs, Boogie Wonderland, during that tribute that will air this Sunday on CBS. CBS This Morning Saturday co-host Michelle Miller caught up with the 1970s supergroup on tour.
Good morning, Earth, Wind, and Fire. Got it.
I can barely hear that, and I can tell it sounded horrible.
Man. You see him straighter?
Jonas Brothers. Like, man. And all the people you can cover that band.
Man.
I mean, I get it, but like, come on. I'm trying.
In the astrological chart of the band's founder, Maurice White. And though he died 3 years ago after complications from Parkinson's disease, the surviving members of the band are still inspiring audiences around the world. We met them at Northern California's Mountain Winery, where they continued to spread White's music and, more importantly, his spiritual message of unity to generations of fans.
After nearly 50 years, Earth, Wind, and Fire still rehearses before every show. Don't you know the words by now?
That's what everybody says, but you can never not work on your craft. You're always working on it every day, you know, particularly the level we want to stay at.
And work in unison.
If rehearsal starts at 8 in the morning, I'm there at 7. If it starts at 10, I'm there at 9.
Everybody?
Yes. I wasn't leaving my brother. I love my brother.
Right.
I wasn't I was going to stick it out.
I had auditioned as a drummer.
Detroit.
The brothers first drafted drummer Ralph Johnson, then singer Philip Bailey.
We went to Philip's house. Reese and I did.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I think it was on a Sunday night, too.
Mm-hmm. You remember that detail?
Mm-hmm.
And you said?
Well, Reese talked to him, and he said, "I just want to be in the best band in the world."
How'd that turn out?
Well, we are here.
Do you remember? Maurice White approached the band's second act as a mission to broaden its appeal and better focus its message.
He wanted to deliver a message of hope and love and respect and raise the consciousness of the people. So each one of us was handpicked.
You can imagine that you're having two failed albums, you know. I mean, I can't blame the rest of the band members. Like, all right, you tried and gave up, but Maurice's like, no, we can, we took it up some, and it just took off.
It was that determination.
Right? Yeah, man.
You know, for this mission.
Would you call it a spiritual journey?
Most definitely.
And all of you were on board with it?
Women. Absolutely.
That goes to another point, you know, there was no drugs or alcohol as part of your mission. I mean, no. As your scene, you lived clean when it came to your food.
Some of us did. We can't tell that lie. There were people in the group who got high.
Okay.
And we got high. Maurice was totally clean. Smoked a whole lot of weed.
There was some experiments going on. You know?
Did you start noticing the crossover taking place?
You know, you can't really put your finger on it, but, you know, a hit don't hurt you. You know, Shining Star pretty much just broke the door open.
Shining Star first topped Billboard's Hot 100 in 1975, and the hits kept coming.
It was just an electrical time where there was nothing that we could do that was wrong. It was just all, hitting
right.
on all cylinders.
Yeah.
Though it would be years.
It's like hit after the hit after hit.
You can't even say classic, but iconic. Iconic, man.
Yeah, this back to back.
Before he acknowledged his illness, Maurice's diagnosis of Parkinson's disease forced him from touring in 1994. He died in 2016.
We had to make a decision. Could we go on without Maurice? Would the audiences accept us without Maurice? So the three of us took it forward.
Mind you, don't forget now, that hole he had was huge. So we had to like really put it together, which we did.
White, Philip Bailey, and Ralph Johnson continue their mission to bring music to the masses.
And now this, when you see this,
and they've seen that mission accomplished.
Wow.
More than 12 million people have watched this video on YouTube, featuring Earth, Wind, and Fire fans of all ages and backgrounds.
So what does that say to you?
It says that music is a powerful tool. We are very blessed to be a part of something that was and is so well received around the world.
That's crazy, man. Keep music last much longer. Like,
right.
They still on tour.
And just like Kay said, man, the message that it had was just, you heard the songs, and if you were in a down mood, it brought you up.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it's just, and I'll be thinking about like some of today's music, like, you know, how many of these rap or hip hop songs can they take this on tour 15, 20 years from now? Like, right. Will we still remember? I feel like we live in a microwave society now, even in the music industry. You know, it may be hit now, but it doesn't age well.
Man, it ages horribly.
Yeah, like these songs age very well.
They age well, they last for generations. Wow, in this day and age, you'll have songs, especially on the radio, where you'll hear them. 6 months later, nobody wants to listen to it.
Yeah, it's done deal. You know, we're gonna go into the hip hop side of things for a few minutes.
Oh yeah.
And then we'll go back to the to some rock and roll stories.
Yeah.
All right. So this is a clip of Mos Def, like a very young Mos Def.
Yes. Brown skin, I be standing 5'10", I be rocking it when I be in your vicinity. Raw style synergy, recognize symmetry. Come try to injure me, broke them down chemically. Ain't the number 10 MC. Talking about hopping, I be styled it like Kennedy. Late like a 10 to 3. When I say, when I be girl safe and I keep, cause this the 10 MB. Way out like Tennessee. Take me to a place called the BK without pause or delay. Get run like pin relay. Don't deal with he say, she say. Ain't working for no cheap pay. The most death beat play. This what the streets say. Hey, Mr. DJ, play that devil Morgan. That jam got me open. Decided to break it broken. From front side to side, middle to back. Never the whack. I come from Best Star Black. From Louis A. V. E. to be exact. Brooklyn!
Man.
Yo, this probably like. Mos Def is one of my favorite rappers out of Brooklyn. I mean, I know a lot of people say Jay-Z, but for me, it'd be Mos Def. It'd be Sky Zoo.
Man, he's really a wordsmith. Like, when you sit down, you listen. I mean, even that freestyle.
Yeah.
For him to put those words together and for to freestyle and to put those words together and for it to make sense.
Yeah. Oh, for him, but even he'll be an actor first before he even got into music. I mean, he was an actor.
Oh, word.
Yeah, he was a child actor, went into the music, back to acting.
Dang, man.
Yeah, because I saw some clips of him. I don't know, it was a Cosby Show. It was like some of the sitcoms. I mean, he was real young.
Yeah.
And of course, because he took off with Black Star, you know, with Talib Kweli. Yeah. And then he went solo with 1999. He dropped that solo album, Black on Both Sides, which was a great album.
Phenomenal.
Man, like, especially You Know What I Mean Says. Yeah. Like, there was so many great songs on there. And then, like, he went back to acting and you saw him in movies. I mean, he had one big movie with Bruce Willis. I want to say it's called 52 Blocks or something. It was really good. But yeah, he was a great actor too. With Brown Sugar, yeah, those type of movies. Right. And then he was on the soundtrack to that. He had that one breakout hit with him, Pharrell Monch, and Nate Dogg.
Right.
You know, that took off. So, I mean, he had a...
He's a talented brother, man.
Yeah, man. And we said albums that we haven't heard yet. It's supposed to be a Black Star album's done with Madlib as a producer. And you know, Madlib, yeah, recently.
Madlib is a phenomenal.
So he's sitting on that. He's sitting on a completed album of him and Manny Fresh.
Dang,
they never came out, and this was done like five. I want to say it'd been more than 5 years, but he wasn't released. It never came out.
I wonder how that was sound.
Man, like I thought that was an interesting mix.
Right.
You know what I mean? But I mean, he had one song. He flipped from New Orleans, and he put his own flavor to it, and it came out pretty dope.
Word.
Yeah, so you know, so he got more stuff, and then he had another album he dropped a few years ago that I haven't heard, but he only released it as an exhibit. Like, you had to go to the museum to hear the album.
Are you serious?
Yeah. Like, so you go to the museum, you had to pull on the headphones, and that's the only way you can hear this album.
Man, can you imagine just a line of niggas waiting to use the headphones?
Yeah, I mean, but you weren't the only one. Wu-Tang did the same thing. They have an album like that, too.
Oh, you're talking about the one with Shaquille?
That he bought.
Whatever his name was.
Yeah, he bought that. Manny Fresh, last time I saw him, in the mall, like years ago. Yeah, I saw him in Lenox Mall.
Oh, man.
And, he's still kicking because he was a big boy. Like, he eating good. he eating good. Like, he's straight. And he did lots of behind the scenes, too. He did stuff with T.I. and other people after he left Cash Money. So, he did a lot. He's still kicking, though. Working. Yeah, but I saw him like, but he eating good. Like, he ain't struggling. I know that much.
I mean, with the amount of stuff he produced, he better not be struggling.
Yeah, absolutely.
Hey, Birdman couldn't do to him what he did to Wayne.
Man. Yeah, man. Well, like you say, man, but he had the ability to go out and network and do other tracks for other people and make other hits.
Exactly.
So that was pretty dope. This next one here, all right. So now we're about to get into sampling a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
And this is a video with Knife Wonder. Now, you'll know who Knife Wonder is. Knife Wonder is a producer from North Carolina. Mm. And he was part of a group called Little Brother. And they had a good little run.
Right.
Little Brother consisted of him and two other rappers. And they all had their own careers, you know, Pooh and Fonte.
Yeah.
All right. But Knife Wonder, anyway, he took up. So I guess after Little Brother, he kind of took over as a producer. And what made Knife Wonder so special? He did something for Jay-Z,
right?
And not only because he did a beat for Jay-Z, it is the fact that he did it completely on his laptop. Like he went for some reason he was in New York.
Yeah.
Jay-Z like we like, and then so Jay-Z like, well, I want this, this, and this. So he think like, all right, well, just Jay-Z like, well, just get at me whenever you go back home and do it.
Right.
And I wonder, he just went to the lobby, whipped out his MacBook, and, you know,
did it right there.
And he's like, damn. So it was like, at the beginning of the era when people was like doing all their beats on the computer.
Right.
And I guess Beyonce was around at the time. Jay-Z and Beyonce were together privately before they went public.
Right.
And so from there, but I wonder, I think he did something for Blueprint. And that's one of his, Jay-Z's best albums, I guess. And, like, I'm not a Jay-Z fan, but I did like that album. And, yeah, so he kind of took off from there,
right?
You know, and so now, like, so with Dave Warner talking about, he sampled, he did a beat for Kendrick Lamar on his last album, which Damn, yeah. So he's gonna break that down,
man.
Yeah, it's funny because like it's so interesting when you break it down, it's so interesting how he did it,
right?
But Knife Wonder, and Knife Wonder now, I knew I was getting that. I had a brain fart. So Knife Wonder started his own label.
Yeah.
Of course, he signed Rhapsody.
Oh, yeah.
That's his artist.
Yeah, I remember
So now you see Rhapsody kind of blown up as a female artist.
Right.
And look at who she signed to. Roc Nation. Mm. So it's like this whole little circle.
It comes full circle.
Yeah. So this is crazy. But yeah, so we're going to get it. I didn't want to introduce it before I went into it. But this is Knife Wonder.
Beyonce, her dad came in and he heard the song Girl playing loud. He said, oh, this is a smash. This is a hit. He looked at me and was like, you made this beat, son? I said, yes, sir. And Beyonce turned to him and said, Daddy, he made it on that.
In hip hop, sampling is like alchemy. It's an art form that rearranges space and time. And the producers who build on the tradition use sonic DNA from the past to cook up the future. Now, even when you know how it works, it can still feel like magic.
Man, I love that explanation, man.
Yeah.
The name Knife Wonder says it all. A proven innovator with a disciplined approach, he lends every sample he touches his own sense of soul. It becomes clear in surprising ways when he breaks down the three beats he composed that all went into a single song from Kendrick Lamar's Pulitzer-winning album, Damn.
The first song I sampled in Kendrick Lamar's Duckworth is a song by Ted Taylor, and the song was called Be Ever Wonderful.
Just to remind you, sweetheart, that my love for you has
a lot of times producers listen to samples and they say, that's a great sample, but he didn't do it right. It's just like fashion. And maybe a shirt on this side, the jacket's over here, but it takes a mind to put all those together. It's the same thing with records. It's like, if you don't know how to dress this up, man, just don't wear it. Sometimes people make beats and don't understand body motion means a lot, especially when it comes to the region you're making the beat for. So if I'm thinking of classic West Coast, I'm thinking this, I'm thinking of all the like different, you know, foot movements and all of that stuff. And I also knew that Ludacris used this for Splash Waterfalls.
The same sample.
So now I'm thinking, okay, I have to flip it another way. So I'm fighting against three or four different thought processes. The second song that I sampled in Duckworth for Kendrick was called Ostabi Tribe.
Man, just the way he broke that down, because the way he flipped the sample, he was even thinking about the regionality of the artist. He had the artist in mind, and it's like somebody who tailors a suit.
Right. Yeah. Like, so he make every beat for North Carolina boom bap.
Right. Exactly.
You know, yeah. Like I said, he came from North Carolina. Like, right. Even when he said yes sir to Beyonce's dad, like, okay, this dude from the South.
That was so
right. You know, like I even talked to kids. I'm like, yes sir, yes ma'am. Just out of habit.
That's
know?
How you talk.
Yeah, but yeah, for him to be custom make a beat for someone on the West Coast the way he did it, and it sounds West Coast.
Right.
He took an old record and he made it sound West Coast, and I remember Ludacris' song,
right.
And it sounds Southern.
Right.
Exact same sample.
Same sample.
Yeah, it's crazy.
That's a lot going on. Progressive rock or prog rock has been a thing that a lot of us has been sampling for a while. Wow. As Q-Tip started sampling jazz, Dilla and Madlib really started to go to other countries and started digging there. So prog rock became like a thing. If I have a loop or a part of the sample that I want, I piece it together in my mind like a puzzle. I have this part. I have a middle to go along with it. Now I need an end.
He beat the case and went back to hustling. Bird shuffling, Anthony rang. The first in the projects with the two-tone Mustang.
The third song that I sampled is
So he's three samples on this one song for three different generations.
Close friends of mine. Atari by Hiatus Coyote. one of my producers, Cash, came to me and said, man, it's some sounds on this record. We started to go through the record and I ran up on
out over the edge of
fire. I read in an article one time that P-Rock said that he did 25 beats a week. That's 1,000 jumpers a day. Am I shooting 1,000 jumpers a day? Or am I shooting 200 jumpers a day? And so I started to...
Yo, One Nation, he said, I be saying yes sir stuff too. I'm southern, mostly females, correct me, young and old. Don't say that I'm not that old. I'm like, chill, it's a habit. I try not to say that to people. Yes.
Do you live up north? Did you move up north? Because, man...
I get the same thing. Like I'm not trying to be offensive. They're just being respectful.
Man, but people from up north take it as disrespect when you say it, because they think you're being sarcastic.
But even sometimes now, well, the newer generation, I say that. Like, if I say yes, ma'am, to somebody, they might think I'm, like, are you trying to call me old? Like, I get that. I get that here. And I'm just like, no, like, I'm just being respectful. Like you mad? You don't want nobody calling you the B word. You don't want to do no cat calls.
Right.
I'm saying yes, ma'am. That's bad. Like, what do you want?
Like, you can't win.
Like, ain't win.
You can't win, child. You can't win.
Come up with a thing called 30 before Thursday. I start on Monday, and my goal is to have 30 beats before Thursday. I will listen to every song on the record. So by the time another producer came along, they say, man, you took every great sample off of this record. There's nothing left. So after a while, you know, I had like 8 Hiatus Coyote beats. So now I'm sampling the now. No, and sampling my friends.
Crooked cops told Anthony he should kick it. He brushed him off and walked back to the Kentucky Fried Chicken. See, at this chicken spot, there was a light-skinned nigga that talked a lot with a curly top and a cap.
I'm just doing what Pete did for me. Pete and Prem did for me and what James Brown did for them. It's still just a paying it forward. I just always look at it as a link in the chain, man. Like, it's a link in the chain. So it trips me out, but, you know, I still... Man, these young boys getting better. This is not like the NBA where you can retire. Like, this is, you have to keep going. That's what makes Duckworth the joint, because of that. Three countries, the sample came from three different countries with three different generations, three different genres, covering all parts of Kendrick's life, involving three people, him, his dad, and Top Dog.
Did y'all ever have that conversation?
Nah, I'm hitting him today and I'm gonna ask him. I'm hitting Kendrick today.
Yo, so... I don't know if y'all heard the album or not. I mean, I'm a Kendrick Lamar fan, so I have heard the album. This song is towards the end of the album.
Yeah.
And and he's right. That song is about Kendrick, his dad, and I want to say and Top.
Right. Yeah. You know, it's kind of wrap up.
Yeah. So it's funny, like you said, it's funny that he had a beat with three different samples, three different generations, and then his song is about, you know, three different generations.
Right.
Telling the story, and he basically says Kendrick telling the story of how his dad and Top Dog, they had a run into each other when Kendrick was small.
And that's
him. You know, and you know, and they run the streets. And you know, and Kendrick's imagining if that encounter went the wrong way, right, Kendrick wouldn't be here and Kendrick wouldn't be working for Top. You know, it's just,
man,
it's crazy. Yeah. So I already loved the song for what it was, but after seeing his video, of seeing the producer breaks it down,
right,
I love the song even more now.
Because it's like he was there with him.
Yeah.
He was there with him. And that's the thing about music. It's somewhere where, of course, with all art, there's thought that goes into it. With all art, there's structure.
Yeah.
You have to know structure in order to break structure.
I like the fact when
tell folks.
I like when Knife was talking about how he made like 30 beats a week. You know, right, what I'm saying? Because, right, like, I know when I really started getting into photography and stuff, I was just like, when I was in Mississippi, I was just knocking out a whole bunch of photo shoots. Like, I was just... Cause I was like, you know, I was young and I knew the competition was great and I knew how to catch up. Right. And the best way to do it is to keep shooting. I mean, and I made a lot of mistakes. I had a lot of effed up shoots to get to the point. Yeah.
But it keeps you sharp.
You know, and it's funny, man, like between that and writing, the magazine was combined both of them to what we're doing right now.
Right.
I mean, like I said, and like, I feel like we have a pretty decent show that we put together. I mean, I know Comcast acting up tonight on our video, but all those years of skill came up to what we have right here with the Black Narrative, you know. And
everything builds up, man.
Yeah, and I love it, man. But it's the beautiful struggle, they call it.
Exactly.
You know? So I F with it. This next one here is a short interview with Andre 3000. Oh yeah. I saw your message there. Yeah, we both from the South. I was born in Mississippi. I raised in Decatur, Georgia. So yeah, so Atlanta's home. I'm from old Atlanta. And like I say, you know, my parents, Mississippi, man. So I was raised to say yes, sir. Yes. My grandfather, he's more of a father figure in my life, from my early years. So he instilled that in me young, saying yes, sir, yes, ma'am. I mean, this, and like me being the age I am now, I still do that. You know, right, it doesn't matter, right. You know. Yeah, but I'm from the South. One of my favorite albums. Oh, yeah. Out of Kendrick Lamar albums.
Man.
I love them. I think Good Kid, Mad City is still, well, you know, I was just listening to Section 80 the other day. Section 80 was a great album, to last mixtape with Kendrick.
Man, for me, that's hard. I would say it's probably between, and this might sound a bit odd, of course, Good Kid, Mad City. Because, I mean, Good Kid, Mad City has a special place in my heart for where I was during that time.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But also, I really love Untitled Unmastered. I feel like it's...
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
Man, I have that album on repeat so
I forgot
much,
about that.
Man.
That was dope.
Because...
I go back and listen through it.
Right. And of course, you know, I love To Pimp a Butterfly. But Untitled Unmastered is a good little listen to... It's interesting seeing it feels a bit intimate in a way.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
I feel like To Pimp a Butterfly is the most artistic album.
Exactly.
I mean, right. I don't listen to it as much as other albums, it's heavy.
And that's it's interesting, man, because I have these conversations with my friend where certain albums are like books, like big books, where you go back to them during a special time.
Yeah,
you can't run them to the ground.
Yeah, it's true. You gotta let them marinate.
Right. Yeah, right. You gotta sit with them.
And that's what I feel like with The Butterfly. But I think but lately I've been going back, like Section 80, the OD mixtape.
Right.
Cause I didn't realize on Spotify, Section 80 was missing some songs.
Really, which ones?
Well, only one I found out so far is Spiteful Chant with Schoolboy Q.
Oh,
and I love that song. So I had to go to YouTube to listen to that song because it's not on Spotify for whatever reason. Yeah. Good Kid, Mad City has a great flow beginning and end.
Right.
Damn, you need that little kick in the morning.
Right.
That was damn good for me. I mean, I guess that was like Intelligent Trap. I guess the best way to describe Damn.
Right, seriously.
You know, and then...
And also, if you guys ever get a chance to look at Kendrick's, I'm not going to say B-side, but back when Spotify was kind of like a newer thing,
mm-hmm.
and he used to just drop stuff on Spotify, because you remember when he had the Heart series?
Man, I forgot about that, yeah.
Heart 1, 2, 3, and then, man, cartoons and cereal with Gunplay?
Yeah. I think Gunplay had him on that track, too.
Yo.
Gunplay had him.
No, that... verse, to me, Gunplay had a classic. And mind you, Gunplay's from Florida.
Yeah,
that's like a classic Southern verse.
Yeah, it was.
The way he delivered that, man, you just,
man, you gotta be going back tomorrow listening to this catalog, man, because you brought up some stuff. I forgot about the Heart series. Yeah. Somebody asked about our names. I'll let you go first.
Well, I mean, the reason I chose the name Akis is, I mean, it's Spanish for X, because you don't have to know my identity. It's one of those things where, and I kind of thought about it with, I mean, Malcolm X as well. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? The X as far as just crossing out that oppression.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It has, the X has many different meanings, but the X doesn't have an identity.
Mm-hmm.
What's important is what's being said.
Mm-hmm.
Not who I am as a person.
Yeah.
Not my identity, you know.
And that's real.
What's being said is what's important.
Right. Anybody looks at your, you know, your propaganda or anything, like, and straight to the chase.
Right, and it tries to take the ego out of it.
Yeah.
As much as possible.
Yeah, for me, man, for Black Ice, I had this name for a while. I was
Micey exposed my secret.
Because he hasn't seen his face before. That's funny. As far as Black Ice, I had his name for over a decade. Before we had it, so the vibe going off right now. As far as Black Ice, before we did this production, I would say photographer for many years. Yeah, still am, I guess. Photography and also did publishing. I had a magazine, and so I'm a writer. I published a couple books and stuff. But anyway, during the photography time, I was doing a lot of projects, and I did some celebrity photography stuff. I won an award for my photography 1 year. And so at the, I'm like a key in the sense of I've always been about my work. Now, don't worry about me, I'm about the work.
Right.
So
right.
Social media, for a long time, people didn't see my face. Only thing you saw was my work.
Right.
And so it was this magazine in Atlanta. They gave called Spider Magazine, and they gave me a Photographer of the Year award. And the editor in chief, and this is like probably right before I had my magazine. So the editor in chief, she tracked me down and everything. Like, yo, I want to give you this award. I really love your work. I've been following your work for a while.
Right.
And I guess the best way to describe my photography work, I was doing a lot of more conceptual, artistic type photography with a little edge to it, I guess.
Right.
And I kept it simple, sexy, and clean, I guess. It would be the best way to describe it. And so when she, so we met up, and she was surprised how young I was. You know, and like I said, this was years ago.
Right.
So, you know, I was in my 20s. And so she thought, but based off of the quality of the work I was putting out, she thought I was older. And so she's like, so we worked together on a few projects. And so one day she was like, you know what, and my government name is very bland. So like, you look up my government name, it'd be a whole bunch of white people pop up for I would.
Right.
So I was kind of hard to find too, so at the time. So she was just like, I'm gonna call you Black Ice. So us being in Atlanta, first thing came to mind was Goody Mob. I'm like, Goody Mob, Black Ice. I mean, I love that song, but you know, right. But she's like, no, you know, she was like, she's thinking like the conditions, like in Atlanta, we don't have snow. We have Black Ice.
Which is a horrible thing.
It's a horrible thing down here. We already don't know how to drive. So right. Black Ice, you know, people getting killed.
It's kind of like, Mario Kart where you throw the banana.
Yeah, they see. Anybody driving like that?
Right.
Yeah. So she's like, yo, I'm gonna call you Black Ice because we don't see it, but we feel it.
Right.
So I was like, damn. Like my mom was like, you know. So she's like, yeah, but like so she was like, well, we never see you, but we see your work, we feel your work.
Right.
And so from then on, I just started branding myself as Black Ice, and now it became easier to find as far as photography and stuff too. Are you thinking weed? Are you thinking weed? No, it wasn't weed related, man. Yeah. But
even though you are a stoner.
Yeah, right. I'm probably like the only person in Atlanta that don't smoke, I feel like.
So but
yeah.
Three of y'all.
Yeah, basically for real. But yeah, that's so that's the name Black Ice came from. So yeah, so this is the first production that I'm actually showing my face. I mean, to be honest. Because you know, we showed in the previous show before we do Q&A, I had like 4 or 5 shows before this, and I was always behind the camera as a producer.
Right.
This is the first time I'm actually being the host of the show,
right?
And so this is our first rodeo, and so I guess that also helped us help this show grow as fast as it has so far, you
right,
know, because
right.
Like I did a lot of my mistakes in previous shows, and so but yeah, just got to a point, you know, you better off doing it yourself, man, because I never wanted to be in front of the camera, to be honest.
Man.
You know, like he can tell you, I went through so many hosts
right.
over the past 6 years. It's trying to, and one of the shows like this. This is the first serious pro-black show, but
right.
But we had like lifestyle type of shows and industry mm-hmm. stuff. And like I said, I was a celebrity photographer per se.
Right.
So, you know, we did like industry type stuff. But people, man, Atlanta one of the places, man, everybody do everything, but nobody reliable.
Right,
I guess
right.
That's the best way to do it. I mean, Atlanta's full of talent, but that talent don't mean anything if not reliable. And, you know, like dude said...
discipline, you know?
Yeah, like old dude said with Earth, Wind, Fire. He right. was like, yo, if rehearse at 10, they're at 9. And we, you know, it's funny because we both like that.
Right.
We're very punctual people. And to me, like, if you can't be on time for the small stuff, how you can be on time for the big stuff? You know?
Exactly.
And so it's funny how, you know, it is us two.
Right.
And a webcam, you know, and you keep it real simple. And I just feel like this show hits so much harder.
Right.
And but I love what we're doing because like the stuff that we're sharing with y'all, these are conversations that we have off air.
Right, exactly.
You know, and amongst our friends, you know, and like I don't have dumb friends. You know, I mean, all my friends, like they have a business, they doing something, like
right,
we having productive conversations, like and
I've always believed in birds of a feather. You know, you want to have people around you that share that mindset of building and not mindset of destruction.
Right, you know. What I mean? Oh, One Nation, I see you. Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, One Nation, yeah. So, this channel was originally used for outlet for all of photography and video work I was doing on that side of things. And, yeah, and this show is not even a year old. So that's why, sorry for the confusion. But, yeah, but that's why. Because even, like, I was directing music videos. Like, that's still one of the highest rated videos on this channel is the video that we did. All the people, it's funny because all the people that died due to police brutality.
Right,
he told me. Yeah, we directed that video way before we even thought about this show. So it's funny how things work out. But yeah, so we do a lot, basically. So it's not like we just sit here and we just talk shit twice a week. We do a lot. I mean, he does a lot behind the scenes himself, and I do too, man. And we have more stuff on the way. We actually working on another show, hoping to debut on the channel later.
Right.
The music channel. Yoshi Vibes, you know, the trap salsa mixes. So we have a lot of dope creative ideas we're trying to get out, you know. And I guess that's part of why January felt so long too. But it been a very
you know what I mean?
It very productive. Right. Well, you know what I mean, One Nation. But yeah, I mean, you try to be productive with our conversations. But yeah, so I mean, we cover a lot. And I feel like as human beings, we all had different layers.
Right.
You know, yeah, appreciate it. I got some new music for Yoshi Vibes I ain't put out yet. Like I was just holding off on the animation. So I'm so glad the animation is done now, so I can push forward with the mixes. And we get the logo done. I love the logo. I like our branding that we doing for our stuff. It's cool, man. So we having fun with it, and we learning and growing as we do these shows. Because some of the topics that we cover, we kind of know about it, but as we try to find the research and the receipts to show y'all, we learn more stuff. And it's funny how the show just grow and flourish, man. So it's just really been awesome. Like, it's a serious show, but we have a lot of fun with it. And like even tonight, like I had a good time, like going through this music, man. Like, you know, like we don't just listen to I don't really like the radio, to be honest. Does the intro have lyrics? Oh no. You good? Like tonight is easy, man. Like we've been heavy all month. But the intro is just instrumentals. Like so, the Yoshi Vibe channel will be all instrumentals.
Right.
Like there'll
be samples from.
So any lyrics you hear on that channel, it won't be in English.
Right.
It's gonna be in Spanish or Portuguese.
Yeah.
Yeah. So and I don't. I mean, he know a lot more than I do.
Yeah.
As far as that, but I just like dope sounds.
As far as Spanish, not no
Portuguese. you're right. Which that would be another great show. Why that One Nation speaks Portuguese and everybody else speaks Spanish?
Man, maybe the Papal Bulls. Because I mean that's where it all came from.
So it's dope, man. But yeah, but I appreciate y'all being here, being with us tonight. I know it's totally different from the other shows, but. Yeah, we feel like, you know, tonight you need to take it easy.
Right,
like I said, it's a fair. January took forever.
Yeah.
It really did.
Let's wrap it up. Let's go to Black History Month.
Right. So, yeah, but you only had a couple more videos, but this is a short video. This is a short interview with Andre 3000.
Tour that celebrated 20 years of Outkast history, you created these jumpsuits. How did you come up with that idea?
I knew these were old songs. I can't say anything new on an old song. And it was sometimes just thoughts on top of my head, sometimes funny thoughts, things to make the audience think, you know? So it was just fun to me and started with one or two suits. I'm gonna keep it going, just changing them up.
What response did you get from your audience about your messages?
The response was great. It was to start a conversation, and that's what it's done. And people start to even make up their own messages. I saw so many people with black suits on, and I was like, oh, this is cool, you know?
So your jumpsuits will be part of an art exhibit, a collaboration with SCAD at Art Basel, Miami. Why is the exhibit called I Feel Ya?
That came about because some other music artists performed live on television, and they made their own suit and said, I feel ya, Andre. I guess she probably singing in a suit that I wore, and she was like, I feel that. So that's kind of how the title came about.
I love it.
Thank you.
When you created those jumpsuits, did you ever think that they would inspire a film and an entire art exhibition?
No, no, that's the cool thing about it. You just never know. One little thing leads to another. I never knew that.
I'm a huge Outkast fan. Like, even through my photography work and the video stuff I've done in the past and the magazine stuff I did in the past, like, Outkast influenced a lot of my work.
Right.
And actually, yeah, Scat, gang, gang. yeah, so the suits that he was wearing, they came from the reunion tour that they did a few years ago.
Oh, yeah.
And I have a story about that, man, because I was there, you know.
Man.
And
I remember, man. I wish you could have went.
Yeah, man. I had to go, man. And like I said, I'm a huge Outkast fan. I didn't hop on Outkast to the second album, to Ain't the Aliens. Like, I had to go back to the first one.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm not going to lie and say I was there from day one because I wasn't, you know.
You're there for day two.
Yeah, I was there day two, right? Yeah, because the second album came in, I was in eighth grade. It was 96, the Olympics came to Atlanta, so that was a real big deal going on. And like, just hearing a hip-hop album, and this particular Outkast album, the intro started off in Latin. It was a woman speaking Latin. Like, that was just, my mom was just blown off a rap album during that time. And Outkast,
it was such a huge shift from Southern Playlist.
It was. But, you know, it's amazing how some people love Andre now, but I don't think a lot of people really appreciated Andre when he was part of Outkast. Like, they appreciate him now, but you gotta think about him. He was going against the grain back then. Like, they were the Outkast of the industry, literally.
You know how hard it, man. 90s Atlanta.
That is a whole different vibe in itself. I call it old Atlanta. Cause this new Atlanta, trash. Right? Like, don't move to Atlanta now. That's trash. Trust me. Old Atlanta was lit. And excuse me, but yeah, like I said, it inspired so much of my work over the years. And so when they find the reunion tour, Andre always said he wasn't gonna rap past 40. So I was like, I knew he was reaching 40. So I was like, I gotta make this tour, because if I don't catch this tour, there's not somebody to catch him. And I did have the opportunity to catch him live a few times in the past, you know. But I just, you know, as a huge fan, I would catch him again.
Right.
So they announced the reunion tour and their homecoming tour. They come back to Atlanta, right? And so they first announced the tour. The tickets sold out within 30 minutes.
Man.
I was pissed. I was talking about the website broke, phone lines was busy. I couldn't do anything. I couldn't know where I could get myself a ticket.
Right.
So then they announced day two. Mm-hmm. All right, cool. Like, yo, we're gonna do it second day. All right, bet. I just have an opportunity to catch the second day. Again, I couldn't catch the ticket, man. It was 30 minutes. It was completely sold out.
People just sitting there waiting.
Just waiting on it, right? So I was really sad and upset at that point. And at the time, I was actually teaching at this night school thingy. I was teaching the multimedia. Mm. And so while I was there teaching, I get a text message like, yo, Bit Boy's on the radio. He said they're doing a third night, and this is the last night they're going to do. And he's like, tickets going on sale at 8 o'clock. And so I think I was teaching... I was at school from like 4 to 10.
Yeah.
And I think class was like 6 to 10. And this is on the south side of town down by East Point.
Yeah.
And I was like, yo, I got to get this ticket by any means necessary. And online, I know I couldn't rely on the website because Ticketmaster keep crashing. And I was like, you know what? F this. I'm going to Publix. I'm going directly to the grocery store and I'm giving me a ticket printed out.
Right.
But I had to work that night. 8 o'clock. You know, this is middle class.
I know that.
You know?
The angst, man. I'm anxious.
So I had a class full of students.
Yeah.
So but night classes weren't that busy, like, compared during the day, obviously. So I told the class, like, look, and I guess the administrator and I guess the dean, or just like the person under the dean, supervisor, she walked around across the classes at night. You know, just keep an eye on things. So I was like, look, man, I gotta give him some Outkast tickets. I just got to. Like, I do a total class. And these are grown people now, so it's not like I'm teaching high school or nothing. Look, I gotta give him some Outkast tickets, right? And so,
they
like,
understand.
Yeah, right. Yeah, like, they understand. It's like, yo,
especially in East Point.
Yeah, East Point. Oh, yeah, they gotta know.
They
understood. So I told them, like, look, if the lady comes by, tell them I had to take a shit. I start on my legs, like, so then I go to the bathroom. They tell them, like I'm in the bathroom.
Right.
I had to get the ticket. So I timed it out just right to be at Publix right at 8 o'clock. So when the tickets go on sale, I can snatch those tickets and go right back to teaching my class.
Yeah.
So I got up there at 8 o'clock.
Man.
When I get there, because the line was already long, I was like, oh my God. I'm like, oh, not again. Not again.
You have to fight
them. So Publix, you can buy concert tickets. They had, most Publix have a Ticketmaster booth thingy there.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, you get for customer service. They can print your tickets.
Okay.
So, you know, customer service is usually in the front.
Right.
So you talk about, like I said, it was a long line. So you talk about from the front of that line, went all the way back to the meat section in the back. So how long the line was. Like, it goes all through the grocery aisle. Well, everybody there for Outkast ticket.
Maybe some of them were getting lottery.
Yeah. Man, I was hoping, bro. I was like, man. So I was like, so I get back in line, I'm just sitting here like, man, like I'm praying and everything, man. Like, right. Man, I gotta, like, Yahweh, just look out for your boy. Like, even get a ticket. So, but yeah, so I finally at the front line. By this point, it's about 8:30. So, and I remember in the past two nights, they're selling out in 30 minutes. So when I get there, man, like, and if I finally get there, like, fortunately, they had, like, the VIP tickets. They're, like, three levels of tickets.
Right.
The bottommost level of tickets, all they had left already within 30 minutes. So I was able to give me a ticket. I was like, man, like, praise God. Like, yo, I got me a ticket. So that was just wild, like, getting there. So so when I finally make it to the concert, and the third night ended up being the best night. And so people were pissed off at. So people who went there on day one, they bought the tickets first.
Right.
Actually mad at people like me who went the third night. And excuse me. So the reason because every night had different openers.
Right.
So the first night was Kid Cudi. I ain't with Kid Cudi. So, yeah. But I did go down there. I did go downtown that night because, like, I didn't want to be around the energy, right? Like Outkast fans and everything. So I did walk around that night, but I just wasn't there. But first night, Kid Cudi.
Yeah.
I forgot what was the second night, but the third night was the best night because all the OGs was there. Man. Raheem the Dream, A Ball, MJG. Bum B, Kilo Ali, like, I mean, wow. I think I once, what's the trick that he there? Save the best for last, man. Like, it was just nothing but Southern Legends opening, you know, Killer Mike, all of them was there. So that was like the perfect night to be there and to catch it. And then also that same night, Erykah Badu would happen to be there. Well, and so, you know, Erykah Badu is Andre's baby mama, you know, whatever.
You didn't look her in the eyes, did you?
No. So she, you know, they had some songs together, and off the Stankonia era, and that's the first time ever they performed a song live, and I was there for that.
That's the first time ever.
First time ever, you know, and it's also the first time that Andre did songs off the Love Below, because he didn't tour the album.
Right.
When Andre said he didn't care about money, he is so serious about that. Like, he literally gave away probably over $40 million in endorsements and concerts that he just refused to do.
Right.
Yeah, he really is about the music. Like, he said, he gets the point. But he told us a long time ago, he felt like he had to sell out. He just quit. Right. You know, and that's what he did. You know,
and
you got to think about it, these albums went platinum, double platinum, triple platinum.
Right.
And he didn't even go on a tour. That was money.
Right.
Now, he didn't tour those albums. Yeah, so, like, yeah, man. But I wanted to show more Outkast stories tonight, but I didn't want to get flagged because they want to be up there. I don't want to get snatched off air, you know. But I had to tell a story, man. That was really dope. So we got two more videos. They're real short, but these are really hilarious. It's animated. And I was trying to find one of the videos from the last Black Music History video that we did, and I couldn't find it. I had the wrong artist, but I found it for tonight. So it was dope. Yeah, so this one, Well, they both did it with Prince.
Yeah.
They both did it with Prince. Okay. Yeah, so the last two videos about Prince. You get into it.
The Time found its trademark move to compliment Morris totally by accident, courtesy of Jerome Benton.
Oh, and this is real quick background. Artists are petty. So Prince had a rivalry not only with Michael Jackson, he had a rivalry with Morris Day. But they were on tour together. They're like frenemies, I guess. So this is about them too.
Terry's brother.
Jerome was always kind of a roadie for Flight Time. In the old days. So he was organizing stuff and making sure everything was packed up and, you know, that kind of thing.
He's just one of those guys. You can't help but love Jerome. And he was at every rehearsal.
We used to rehearse in this place called the YASM, the Young African American Society of Men or something like that. I don't know. Anyway, it was just like this little club. There was a guy named Weaver that ran the place. Weaver let us come in during the day and rehearse.
First day, we witnessed Weaver hit this guy. And knocked him down the street about 10 feet. It just knocked him out cold. So nobody ever wanted to contest.
No, you didn't mess with Weaver. There were two things that Weaver said, don't mess with in the club. He said, don't mess with my juice machine, And he said, don't mess with my titty lamps.
Don't break them.
Don't break my titty lamps. So the titty lamps were these lamps, but off the base of the lamp was these girls, like, with titties, right? So we were like, okay, we were cool. Jesse was our guitar player, and Jesse's like in the juice machine every day. And he'd pour some water or something in there to make it look like it's the same level. And we're like, oh, Jesse, stay out the juice machine.
So, you know, we started rehearsing, and there's a part in one of the songs where I say, somebody bring me a mirror.
On the sides of this club, there were all these big mirrors, like hanging mirrors, like, right? And the next thing we see, Jerome goes to the wall, pulls this big ass mirror, puts it in front of Morris. Morris starts primping his hair and doing, you know, fixing his tie. And Prince falls out on the floor laughing. And he just goes, we're adding that to the show. That's him, that's him.
From that moment on, he became Jerome the Mirror Man Benny.
But when Jerome put the
Man, we just get a bunch of niggas in the room.
That's hilarious.
Like, bro, I like that part with the mirror, bro.
Yeah, put it in the show. We put it in the show. But don't mess with the titty lamp.
Here, back on the wall, the titty lamp got broke. I remember they kind of fix it. They try to glue it or whatever. They turn it, they put it against the wall, whatever. So Friday night, Weaver walks in. We said, oh, there's Weaver. Hey, Weaver, what's going on, man? Weaver goes,
no.
Who been in my juice machine? We're like, hey, yeah, I don't know what you're talking about, man. He says, and somebody broke my titty lamp.
Man, the characters that they come across when they're touring.
Oh, man. Right. Oh, man. And by the way, these videos are done by the same guy, Mike Judd. He did King of the Hill, if you recognize the animation style. Oh, man. So we got one more. This is Prince and Rick James.
This one is, and you know, both of them are some characters.
Yeah, man. So oh, my gosh.
Ops in Buffalo, they had found a new nemesis, a rival who would push Rick James for the rest of his life. The artist.
But, I mean, Prince was beefing everybody, man.
Man.
Hey, but Prince only like 5'1".
Right.
And that's with heels on.
Ops in Buffalo, they had found a new nemesis.
Hold up, man.
Man, bro, it's just funny.
Yeah.
You trying to find a part two?
Yeah. Because the other part is when they had the after party, and that's what I really wanted. Oh, this is a part two and a part three.
This is
the part two.
Let's see which one got the party.
Oh no, we keep the party going. Oh, yeah. I'm liking this. Let's keep it going.
Yeah, well. Doing it.
Yes, Eddie Murphy did a song.
Man, he did a couple, man.
Yeah, but they didn't want to F with you like that. All right, I got one more part here. I just found. Sorry, my eyes, we just not finding these.
Hopefully, it's the one with the party.
No, I think that's the one with the party. I've been looking for this. This is the one.
Okay, yeah.
All right.
From the very beginning, there was definitely a tension between the revolution and the time.
Alan Leeds had some experience as a tour manager by the time he started with Prince. His first stint on the road was with James Brown.
Hey, kid, 5 minutes.
The time really came to determine to run the revolution off the stage. That was their goal in life, is we're going to kick them in the ass. And we're going to show Prince. And more nights than not, they did that.
We competed about everything. The best car, the best outfit,
so
the best song, you know, the best stage performance. Yeah. It was all competition driven.
The rivalry was intense both on and off.
Urban party. Ours was a straight up basement party. You know, you come in, folks would be naked on the bed, dancing with the lampshade on their head, and it was just madness.
One night, I by mistake got off on the Times floor. And I took one step out of the elevator and realized...
Oh, damn. You got pulled.
Ah, man.
Damn.
What do you think it was?
Probably one of those videos for Prince.
Dang.